qualitative analysis of minimal localization in SYK type models. So please start.
Thank you. Thank you for your kind introduction. Also, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this chance to give a talk at this wonderful workshop. So today I would like to tell you about a recent work on quantitative analysis of many-body localization in such the VH type models. So this is the plan of my talk. So after introducing the such the VH type model as a maximally chaotic quantum mechanical model, I introduce a modification of the model, which we call the SYK 4 plus 2, which deviates from the chaotic behavior. We argue that this is a many-body localization and show that we can analytically predict the many-body transition point and inverse participation ratio. They agree with the numerical results based on exact diagonalization. Also, we discuss whether the eigenstate outside the localized regime is ergodic by studying the entanglement entropy. Actually, at the end of my talk, I would like to point out that a simple Hamiltonian, much simpler compared to the SYK model, could behave like the SYK model, which I believe has not been discussed elsewhere before. So if you know someone working on this variant of the sparse SYK model without Gaussian random coupling, please let me know. So this is a list of my collaborators and our papers related to the such the VH type model. Today, I mainly talk about the SYK 4 plus 2 model, whose chaotic to integrable transition we studied in this paper, and then mainly talk about the results in these two more recent papers. First, I introduce the SYK model. The Majorana fermion version of the model looks like this. Here, N is the number of Majorana fermions chi, and J, A, B, C, D are independent Gaussian random couplings with a constant variance and average zero. For any combination of four out of N Majorana fermions, as in this figure, we have one random coupling. Mathematically, we can see this as a hypergraph in which each edge is connecting not two, but four vertices. To illustrate better what the SYK model is like, let us consider here a single term of the 10 Majorana fermion SYK model. Here, Q equals 4 means that 4 fermions are interacting in each term because we can generalize the model to other even numbers Q, like 6 or 8. We can combine 2 Majorana fermions to create a 1 Dirac fermion or a qubit, then for 10 Majorana fermions, we can consider 5 qubits. Each can take states 0 and 1. So there are 32, 2 to the 5th, states in the Fock space. Each Majorana fermion flips the complex fermion state with a different state depending on whether you have, for example, A or B in your term. So this particular term, J, A, C, E, G times chi A, chi C, chi E, chi G, connects states four hops apart in the five-dimensional hypercube representing the 32-state many-body Fock space. So it connects two states, for example, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, as well as other 15 pairs of sides. The model was proposed by Alexei Kitaev in 2015, and realizes the same low energy behavior as the Sachdev-Yeh model proposed much earlier in the large N limit. Actually, the Dirac fermion version of the SYK model has also been known in a different name in the nuclear theory context, the two-body random ensemble that has been studied from about 50 years ago. Then what are the interesting behaviors that have attracted much attention in the last 5 or 6 years. The SYK model is said to be solvable, but in what sense? So in the large N limit, quantities such as the two-point Green's function can be exactly calculated after sample average. To see this briefly, let us set non-perturbative Hamiltonian equals to zero and consider the Feynman diagram expansion with the SYK Hamiltonian as a perturbation. So the free two-point function is diagonal in the Majorana fermion index in the following, and the product of two couplings averages to zero if at least one of the indices is different. So most diagrams average to zero. So we can show that only a certain type, Menon type diagrams, survive after we take the average over couplings by comparing these two diagrams as an example. So the first diagram averages to non-zero only if the two couplings here and here are the same, so they are connected by a dotted line. So for each I, the number of non-zero diagrams is on the order of n to the third, which is then multiplied by the overall coefficient squared, which is n to minus third. So the contribution of this type of diagram is order one. On the other hand, in the diagram to the right, so this JKL has to be equal to J prime K prime L prime as a set, and M can also be chosen freely. So there are on the order of n to the fourth such diagrams that survive, but there are four couplings, 1, 2, 3, 4. The overall constant is on the order of n to minus six, and the contribution is 1/n². So in such a way, we can show that the Menon diagrams, this type of diagram, as in the figure here, dominate in the large n limit. So in the diagram expansion, dominant diagrams are these Menon type diagrams that can be organized like this. Then in a geometric sequence, so they can be summed up, and we obtain an equation connecting the single particle Green's function and the self energy. In the low energy limit, I omega can be ignored compared to other terms. So we obtain an equation which is invariant under deparameterization in imaginary time. This occurs in the low energy limit and after taking average over the random parameters. So this invariance is imagined. For details, please refer to these publications. So we can obtain the large n saddle point solution, and then the invariance is no longer for arbitrary deparameterization, but this breakdown of the symmetry is in the same way expected for a theory dual to 1+1 dimensional gravity. More specifically, JT gravity, which is dilaton gravity near the horizon of a near extremal black hole. Further evidence of holographic correspondence to black holes is obtained by studying the out-of-time ordered correlators. So in an analogy to the classical chaos case, we can consider out-of-time ordered correlators in quantum systems to extract the Lyapunov exponent, characterizing the chaotic dynamics. So it has been argued that black holes are fastest quantum scramblers, so they are expected to have the largest Lyapunov exponent. Maldesanashenka and Stanford proposed that the upper bound of the Lyapunov exponent is written as a product of the temperature and fundamental constants. This OTOC can also be calculated by diagram expansion for large N S by K model. And in the low temperature limit, it can be shown that the chaos bound is reached. In these plots, the ratio of the Lyapunov exponent to the chaos bound is plotted against the inverse temperature in the horizontal axis. So both for large Q and Q equals 4 case. Q is, as I have said earlier, the number of fermions interacting in each term. So there are now several works connecting the 0+1 dimensional such FA and S by K models, 1+1 dimensional JT gravity, and random matrix, which are maximally chaotic fast scrambling systems. There are different classes of random matrix models, but the type corresponding to the S by K model is the Gaussian random matrix, which I explain briefly in the next slide. So this may be data technical, but Gaussian random matrices are Hermitian random matrices with each independent matrix element obeying Gaussian distribution. The probability density function is written like this, with beta equals 1, 2, 4 for real corresponding, real complex and quaternion matrix elements. The joint distribution function for the eigenvalues is shown to be written like this, and the separation to the beta power indicates that energy levels repel each other. But the strength of the repulsion depends on the ensemble type indicated by this beta. So the distribution of the normalized level separation in the left plot is in proportion to the beta power here for small distance, but the tail is suppressed as Gaussian, much stronger compared to the uncorrelated case indicated by this orange line. Also, the average of the ratio between the neighboring energy separations takes larger values as we go from uncorrelated case to GOE, GUE, then to GSE, which indicates that the levels are more correlated and equally separated with each other. We can numerically check that the level correlation of the SYK model obtained by exact diagonalization is indistinguishable from corresponding Gaussian ensemble determined by symmetry. So for SYK4, N modulo 8 determines whether the symmetry is like GOE, GUE, or GSE. Then we can compare the distribution of such quantities. Here, let me mention that if the holographic principle even holds true in quantum systems, quantum gravity can be studied by experimentally realizing the SYK model. After a proposal to realize the SYK model using ultra-cold fermions in optical lattice, several other proposals have appeared, such as using quantum circuits, a Majorana wire array coupled to a quantum dot, or the Majorana fermions appearing in the holes of superconducting films deposited on the surface of a three-dimensional topological insulator, and using graphene flakes with an irregular boundary like this. In 2019, a paper demonstrating the experimental realization of the SYK model using 8 Majorana fermions with NMR experiment was published. So I said that the SYK model is maximally chaotic in the large N and low temperature limit. What are the requirements for chaotic behavior and gravity interpretation? So it is interesting to deform the model and check what happens. One typical deformation would be to add a random two-body term or hopping to the Hamiltonian. So this could be called the SYK two term with the I in front added to make the term Hamiltonian. The random matrix-like behavior observed for the SYK model like this is lost as we increase the strength of the SYK2 term and becomes close to the uncorrelated case, exponential minus S. Also, the average gap ratio deviates from the Gaussian random matrix value as the perturbation becomes stronger and approaches the uncorrelated case. The Lyapunov exponent calculated for the large N limit does not go to the chaos bound and vanishes at low temperature. The rest of the talk is how this looks like in the basis diagonalizing the SYK2 path. So here, let me briefly introduce many-body localization. After Anderson localization was introduced as a localization of uncorrelated electrons in disordered systems, many people have studied the problem of whether such localization survives if electron-electron or particle-particle in general interaction is important. In the last 15 years or so, several systems that do not equilibrate have been found where the memory of the initial state remains locally accessible for a long time. The reduced density matrix of a relatively small subsystem does not approach the thermal density matrix. The expectation values of local operators for Hamiltonian eigenstates are different from microcanonical average, so the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis does not hold. some of such systems have been realized in experiments, and a standard model in the study of many-body localization is, I think, a spin half Heisenberg chain with a random field in a fixed direction. However, there have been much discussion on the localization of MVL transition point in terms of this H, the strength of the disorder. This is because while exact diagonalization can be conducted only for 30 to 40 lattice sites, some theoretical approaches with various approximations suggest that it requires at least 50 to 100 sites to approach the expectation transition points. So in this work, we look at another model with many body localization, which is SYK4+2, and obtain without fitting parameter the transition point as well as related physical quantities. So now we start discussing the main part. We use n equals 2nd Majorana fermions. Any four of them are interacting randomly in the first term, SYK4, and any two of them are randomly coupled in the second term. So we can choose the set of bases in which the second term is block diagonal, each chi coupled to only with another one. The only parameter remaining is the ratio between the distributions of these eigenvalues and the bandwidth of the first term, determined by the width of the Gaussian random distribution for J, A, B, C, D. Now, SYK4 bandwidth is normalized to unity in the following. So we introduce one complex fermion for two Majorana fermions, and the SYK2 part of the Hamiltonian becomes diagonal in the number of complex fermions, while the occurrence of the many-body localization phenomena should not depend on the choice of basis. By this choice of the basis, we can expect that if this SYK2 term is dominating the Hamiltonian, each many-body eigenstate localizes into one of the product states of the complex fermion states. So in this model with interactions and randomness, we study the many-body localization problem as localization phenomena in this Fock space to each lattice site. In this example, for n equals 14 on the left, this site corresponds to a particular state represented by several bits, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0. Each term of SYK4, this one, connects this state with those having 0, 2, or 4 bits flipped. So the parity of the number of bits in state 1 is conserved, in this case, states even. In this case, with n equals 14, the parity conserving basis consists of 2 to 6 equals 64 states, and each state is connected with 57 states, so most of them. However, if you go to n equals 34, for example, the number of directly connected states only is only 2,517 out of more than 65,000 states per parity. So we see that many-body Hamiltonian is increasingly sparse as n is increased, because the number of neighbors increases polynomially, while the number of Fock states increase exponentially. So we represent the typical value of the mass Vj of the Dirac fermion by delta, this delta. And this characterizes the typical strength of the SYK2 perturbation to the SYK4 model with a bandwidth equal to unity. So the energy of site M in the Fock space is written by a linear combination of the masses Vj with coefficients plus or minus 1. So the width of the energy distribution is square root nd times delta. So if this is smaller than 1 unity, the typical energy difference between arbitrary pair of sites in the system in the Fock space is smaller than SYK4 bandwidths. This is called regime 1. If delta is larger than 1 over square root n, nd, but smaller than unity, the typical energy difference is larger than the SYK4 bandwidth, so larger than unity, but the Hamiltonian flips only up to 4 beats. So the typical energy difference between sites connected, directly connected by H4 is less than the S by K4 bandwidth. So directly connected sites. So this is called regime two. If delta is larger than unity, even the sites directly connected by H4 have typically energy difference larger than unity. So this and this might be connected. Finally, if we approximate the Fock space by a Bessel lattice, so no coming back to the same state, the localization is expected to occur when delta is on the order of n square log n. So the boundary between regime 3 and localized regime 4 is expected to be around there, but we'll check. So we calculate the following quantities to distinguish between the four regimes. The first one is the moments of eigenstate wave functions averaged over the states close to the band center, energy zero. This parameterizes the localization of the eigenstate wave functions, psi, to the lattice sites. And the moments can also be computed by numerical diagonalization by taking the average over the eigenstates close to the band center. In particular, I2 is called the inverse participation ratio, IPR. IPR is 1 over the Fock space dimension if the weights are equally distributed among the basis states, and it reaches unity if there is only one non-zero element of the eigenstate wave function. The second one is the spectral two-point correlation function, which reflects how the energy levels are distributed around the band center, energy zero. So if k omega at small omega is small, this reflects the level reversion due to the random matrix-like or quantum chaos-like energy spectrum. So we calculate these quantities for large n and compare against numerical results. So for details, please refer to our paper, but we rewrite the averaging over random numbers, the random couplings in the system to a matrix integral and obtain a supersymmetric sigma model. Then we obtain a set of saddle point equations and obtain the effective action for which we use the effective medium approximation to compute the physical quantities. Near zero energy, which is the band center of the system, many body energy spectrum, we obtain the average density of states, moments of wave functions, and the eigenenergy spectral statistics. The density of states is almost constant in regime one with very weak perturbation, even if delta is changed around here. But after that, the spectrum is widened by this delta term. So the density of states decreases as 1 over delta, this one and this one. Yeah. The decrease of the number of resonant sites or the spread of wave functions in regimes 2 and 3 as delta is increased is reflected in the moments of wave functions, this IQ. In regime 4, each eigenstate is almost localized into a single lattice site. The critical value of delta for localization is obtained like this. The spectral correlation agrees with GUE Gaussian unitary ensemble random matrix behavior for regimes 1, 2, and 3 when rescaled by the density of states. But in regime 4, Poisson statistics without correlation is predicted by analytical methods. From here, we present the numerical results that are compared with the analytical predictions without free parameters. The inverse participation ratio, IPR, is the sum of the fourth power of the absolute values of eigenvector elements and indicates localization when it is larger. So IP, as I have said, IPR reaches unity when the eigenvector has only one non-zero element whose absolute value is unity due to the normalization of the wave function. The gray lines, this one, and this one, on the plots are the analytical predictions for regime 3 in the previous slide. we observe a good agreement here, here, and here. And then actually here we see some deviation, but this is a corresponds to the fact that while the initial value of I2 in regime one is exponentially small, I2 can only increase in proportion to delta in regime two, which is rather narrow, and in proportion to delta squared in regime three. So I2 can increase only polynomially in polynomial range of delta. It has still to increase exponentially before it reaches the localized value of order one in regime four, the localized regime. In addition to the inverse participation ratio I2, higher moments of the eigenvalue, eigenvectors agree well with the analytical prediction up to delta around unity. For delta equals three, we start to see some deviations for higher powers. We obtain the distribution of the neighboring gap ratio, PR, here, which we plot here together with Poisson and GOE and GUE random matrix ensembles. We measure the deviation by the Kalbach-Leibler divergence. In this plot, we increase delta from 3 to 14, then to 40, and observe that initially, PR was almost identical to GUE, so random matrix, but it approaches Poisson uncorrelated case. The analytically predicted transition point is close to delta equals 40. We plot here the KL divergence together with the plot of the inverse participation ratio I2, this purple curve. So we find that deep inside region regime three, where IPR rapidly increases, the deviation from GUE finally starts to increase and the deviation from Poisson decreases. So to summarize the part of the talk so far, we have studied many-body localization, MBL, as localization phenomena in the Fock space and the SYK model as a tractable system. We have identified four regions in terms of the strength of the perturbation term SYK2, analytical estimates of physical quantities characterizing MBL, inverse participation ratio, and spectral statistics were compared against the results of numerical calculation of these quantities without any fitting parameters. So deep inside the third regime, where the localization rapidly progresses, the spectral level statistics start to deviate from Gaussian unitary ensemble, GUE, one corresponding to chaos, and approach the Poisson one without level correlation. Next, I discuss the behavior of the entanglement entropy of the eigenstate wave functions by splitting the set of Dirac fermions into two subsets. So the physics just outside the many-body localization regime has attracted much attention recently. The question is whether the thermal phase is smoothly connected to spatially extended but correlated states as expected for translationally invariant models before the localization takes place. As an alternative picture, the possibility of non-ergodic extended states trapped in one of the local minima of the energy landscape, but not yet fully localized, have been discussed for several models. We evaluate the entanglement entropy when we split the system into two parts, A and B. The entanglement entropy is defined by the reduced density matrix, rho A, like this. Then we consider NA bit vector L labeled by L and NB bit vector labeled by M. And each basis state is labeled by L comma M. And we evaluate the disorder average moments of the reduced density matrix to obtain this entanglement entropy. So from the condition for the product to survive disorder averaging, we can identify terms that survive. The term involving a single transposition between the indices in this plot between the second and fourth copy can be written like this diagrammatically, and the quantity we need to compute is written like this and this. So as we studied earlier, we have four regimes according to the value of delta, the strength of the SYK2 term. In regime one, all the site levels are within the SYK4 bandwidth, and the wave functions are almost uniformly distributed over the Fock space, while in regimes two and three, fewer sites are energetically close to each other as delta becomes large before localization takes place at n square log n. First, in regime one, the difference of the entanglement entropy from the thermal value, which is the logarithm of the Fock space dimension of A, is exponentially small if the size of A is much smaller compared to the size of B. In regimes two and three, we calculate the entanglement entropy assuming ergodicity. The set of states within with similar energy shell is an extended cluster of resonant sites embedded in the Fock space, and neighboring sites of a site N would be much more likely to be in the same shell than other sites. With some additional assumptions, we obtain this value for the difference from the thermal value. So this can be exponentially larger compared to the case in regime one, the difference from the thermal value. So this offset of the thermal value in our assumption of ergodic states within the energy shell, it is expected to behave like this curve. So we numerically diagonalize 28 site model and compare the offset from the thermal value plotted against NA. We observe a nice agreement between the prediction shown in solid and dashed lines for this regime one and the Plateau-Allan regimes two and three, and the numerical results in red, again without free parameters. So to summarize the main part of the talk, the SYK model is a quantum mechanical model realizing the chaos bound as in random matrices and black holes. And while there have been several experimental proposals and small systems have been realized, we have studied the many body localization phenomena when SYK2 term is added to the SYK4. We studied the MBL as a localization phenomena in the Fock space, which is an over two dimensional hypercube, and obtained analytical results on eigenfunction moments and on the localization point, as well as on the entanglement entropy. The result, based on the assumption of ergodicity in energy shells, is also consistent with numerical results. Before concluding my talk, let me add one more thing. So 1.5 years ago, Brian Swingle proposed a sparse version of the SYK model in which the coupling is Gaussian random at probability P and zero otherwise. If the number of non-zero couplings K times N is too small, some products of fermions commute with the Hamiltonian, so there will be another additional conserved quantity, and there will be no random matrix behavior. Surprisingly, if the number of independent terms K times N reaches around N, so K around one, random matrix-like behavior appears, and non-zero entropy per fermion at low temperatures is observed, which is expected for models holographically corresponding to black holes. This corresponds to the probability of non-zero couplings, this P, on the order of N to the minus third. So this is very, very sparse. But I think the important thing here is while the product of two Gaussian distributions that appear in the diagrammatic expansion is Gaussian, if you take the product of two probability distributions that are Gaussian plus delta function, so at zero, you obtain a similar distribution function. So Gaussian plus some probability times zero. So much, if not all of the arguments for the fully connected SYK4 can be reused in this case. Here I propose limiting the interaction to plus or minus one, which I expect to have a similar behavior as the sparse Gaussian. Specifically, I take the Hamiltonian like this. So with chi being Majorana fermions, I observed random matrix statistics for the number of non-zero terms only as many as the fermions. So this P can be taken very small. And after discussing with several experts in the field, I still do not know other people studying this model. If you know anyone, please let me know. But here, for n equals 20, 20 Majorana fermions, with 22 non-zero terms, some additional degeneracy in the eigenvalue spectrum was sometimes observed. But with 24 non-zero terms, randomly chosen, the distribution of normalized level spacing and the neighboring gap ratio agreed with random matrix values. In this case, because n equals 20, so 20 modulo 8 is 4, and this is a Gaussian symplectic ensemble. Similarly, for n equals 22, with 50 or more non-zero terms, I observe a good agreement with Gaussian unitary ensemble. Also for n equals 24, this is a multiple of 8. GOE Gaussian orthogonal ensemble is observed. For n equals 34, even for this one Hamiltonian, with just 36 out of more than 46,000 terms in the standard SYK4, and without random Gaussian random couplings, I obtained GUE distribution, both for this level spacing and neighboring gap ratio. Even the energy spectrum looked identical to the standard SYK model after normalization, and the spectral form factor, the amplitude of Fourier transform of the energy spectrum that I studied with 8 collaborators 4 or 5 years ago, looks very similar to the standard SYK4. I think that this is very interesting and not trivial, even in comparison to the sparse SYK model with Gaussian couplings by Swingle and collaborators. So let me conclude my talk by showing the summary again. The main results are on these two papers, and I think we will be updating the second one shortly. And for the sparse SYK with couplings limited to plus and minus one, I have not computed the Lyapunov exponent, but if it reaches the chaos band, as in the standard SYK, it would be also interesting to study the gravity interpretation. So thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much for the interesting talk. So are there any questions? So I see some people raise hands. No, okay. Are there any questions? So then please raise your hand. Okay, Ibra, so please ask question.
So thank you very much for the talk. So I have a question. How did you choose the interactions in this shorter Hamiltonian you showed before?
Just randomly. So I generated some random numbers and randomly chose 18 as plus one, 18 as minus one, and the rest zero. So this is the same scheme as Brian Swingle's sparse or pruned SYK. Just the difference is just that I don't use Gaussian random, just plus one or minus one.
I see. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okunishi-san, yeah, please go.
Yes, thank you very much for nice talks. So I have a very elementary questions. So you explained about the four regimes associated with the medi-body localizations.
Yes.
Yes. So should we observe any phase transition behaviors between these four regimes or crossover?
I think it is a crossover.
Crossover, huh?
Yes.
So if so, is it possible to any order parameter like physical quantity? Can you define such a quantity in this phenomena?
Okay, so to be more precise, the separation, the boundary between three and four might be phase transition, because the system becomes localized. So mm-hmm. before this is not localized, and regime four is localized. And if we calculate the eigen energy spectral statistics, then we see clear change. Mm-hmm. And this is reflected in the behavior of the gap ratio distribution. So because n is finite and rather small, yes. it looks like a crossover, but we expect that this is changing more drastically as uh-huh. n is increased.
Oh, I see. Thank you.
Takayanagi-san, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. So interesting talk. I have a question about your final argument about the sparse SYK. Okay. So are there any some critical like behavior as we find for SYK model? I'm just curious how, so what's the dynamical difference between sparse SYK and ordinary SYK?
Because I have just started the calculation 1 or 2 weeks ago. I don't have much information other than I have presented here. Yes. But sometimes there is some additional symmetry in, for example, the GUE case. I'm not sure if I'm directly answering your question, but so sometimes because of such additional symmetry, I don't see, for example, GUE behavior for a specific sample, but for example, GOE or GSE. And this is known in, already known in Gaussian randomness sparse SYK. So please let me know if, I mean, I'm off from your question.
I see. So you said the spectral curve is essentially looks like similar between spectral form, and does that also tell us about the entanglement of the system?
I haven't the spectrum does not directly tell about the entanglement of the system, I think.
I see. So it might be different from this volume row like behavior for this sparse.
Yeah, but I have not checked yet.
I see. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are there any question? So, let me ask one question. So you talked about the SYK model coupled to a two additional fermions. So SYK 4 plus 2.
Yes.
So it's kind of deformation of the original SYK model.
Yes.
But SYK model has some gravitational interpretation using holography. Yeah. But your model, so do you have a similar interpretation in the bulk side?
Sorry, I'm not ready to answer to your question, but we can use some, techniques used for S by K4 to compute the Lyapunov exponent. And so we can derive some effective models in large N. And so for example, we can argue down to some finite temperature, even if with this term, the Lyapunov exponent is very similar to the S by K4 case. But the deviation appears in low energy.
So do you have conformal symmetry at low energy?
So conformal symmetry is
symmetry. I mean, yeah. So and if you take two-point function of the two fermions, then at the low energy, the SYK model shows some universal symmetry, like it's SL2R symmetry. So, but once you add the additional interaction, so do you still have similar two-point function?
I believe that depends on the type of additional function, additional interaction. So SYK2 breaks such symmetry.
Oh, okay.
But some other people have studied like SYK4 plus SYK6, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And if I remember correctly, in such cases, conformal symmetry is observed.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you very much. So are there any more questions? So if not, let's thank the speaker again.